Great. Hey, welcome. I'm Fred Upton. I'm chairman of the Energy and Commerce Committee. Go by the name Fred. I represent Southwest Michigan. I'm with John Shimkus, and I'll just tell you just a couple things, but we're really anxious to hear from you and talk to you a little bit about some of the things that we've now done, particularly in the last couple of weeks. You can remember well that when the president's health care bill passed in the Congress, President Obama had a promise that you could keep your health care, period. If you liked it, you could keep it. And that was said very much over the last couple of years. Remember, the bill was signed into law back in March of 2010. But even in September of this year, the president said, if you do nothing, if you like your health care bill or your health care, you don't have to do anything, you can keep it and everything's fine. Well, particularly for me, and I'm John is going to speak here in a moment, I know that when I was home, once we ended up getting out of that shutdown period, is I was home with lots of events over the course of those days, particularly over Veterans Day. There was not an event that I went to. The grocery store, a veterans event, a service club, church, you name it, someone was coming up to me and said, Fred, here's my letter. I thought we could keep this. You don't know what this is going to be. I can even remember doing a talk radio show across the state of Michigan, and the fellow that I was talking to at the radio station, his own plan had been canceled. He had gotten, this was like a Thursday, the previous Monday, he was led to believe that it was going to cost him a 400% increase, and his deductible was going to go up in thousands of dollars, and he was just absolutely panicked. So this is an issue that millions of Americans are struggling with. I know in my state, Michigan, nearly a quarter of a million folks were going to receive cancellation notices relating to their individual policies. So I did a bill, just to close, because we want to hear from you. We had a bill on the House floor passed by more than 100 votes a week ago. A lot of Democrats voted for it. A number of Democrats co-sponsored it as well. And it said basically this. It's a one-page bill. Anyone can look it up on the internet, H.R. 3350. Said in essence, if you had health care that was earlier this year, that counts. You're not going to have to pay a penalty. That counts. You can keep that as part of the president's law, and you're not forced to change to something else. So you decide on your own financial standing, your own health standing, you decide whether you want to keep that, and it's good for the rest of the year. So with that, let me turn to John Shimkus, very valuable member, certainly of the Energy and Commerce Committee, and a good friend as well, and represents downstate Illinois. So John, go ahead.
Thank you, Fred. It's great to be here. I want to welcome Deborah, also, and Catherine. You're going to be able to get a chance to tell. Thank you for calling the office, and thanks for following up to provide information to the conference and emails and your story. Just another side story. I just came from a telecom hearing, one of our other subcommittees, and there's some folks visiting from the district. And as we got our picture taken, I'm running over to this meeting. He wanted to talk about the farm bill. And then he says, okay, now I got to talk about how the policy, I cannot keep the policy I once had. And he's I represent 33 counties in southern Illinois, small town, rural. Our farmers are, in essence, self-employed, buy their own health insurance. Here's an example, someone else who just minutes ago said, and I don't know what to do, I can't get on the website, I can't keep my insurance.
It was still down yesterday, Joe.
So we want to welcome you, thank you for joining us. We're real people here, you're real people out there. We need to hear your story, so it's great to be with you through this new medium.
And this is the first time you've done this also, right?
Yeah,
same with
yeah.
me. So, but I know there's a lot of people watching, so I don't know. Yeah, I'm looking. I don't know who's going to go first. Who'd like to go first? You're up. Go ahead.
Someone jump.
Someone starts speaking.
Is she saying something?
You're up.
Am I up?
Yes,
you're up.
Tell us your story.
All right, well, my name's Catherine Kaiser. I teach English in a small high school in southeastern Illinois. And you know, I graduated from Eastern Illinois University, and I got married right after. I've been teaching here ever since, and I'm actually I'm teaching in the same county that I grew up in, so I'm really familiar with the area. Always been here. Not a whole lot of opportunity down here. You know, there's not a lot of jobs in our county or anything. Basically, where we are now is, you know, I teach, so I do have insurance provided through my work. I do have some of a that my employer makes to help out with that. But for me to take the family policy, it would be $1,900 a month, which is roughly my salary. So my husband has insurance through his work also. It's employee only. So the whole time we've been married and had kids, we've got our own policy through Blue Cross. It's great. They have a $250 deductible, 10% on prescriptions. They only pay 10% up to $100, $30 copay, all preventatives covered. But we did get the letter just a while back saying that we couldn't keep that coverage, that policy wasn't being offered anymore because it doesn't meet the minimum requirements. In my opinion, it exceeds them because it's way better. So we had to choose a comparable option in terms of comparable with price or comparable with coverage. The comparable price is $424 a month. They currently pay $465. That would give us a $6,000 deductible, which, you know, on our combined income of about $75,000, to have us pay $425 a month and then an additional have nothing be covered up to $6,000. That's not really a feasible option for us. That's, you know, the difference in do we buy medicine for bronchitis or do we buy groceries that month if that happens. And that's something that really is unreasonable to ask. The comparable coverage, is it a $1,000 deductible, which is nowhere near our $250, and that would cost $721 a month, which is, again, something that we just can't do. So at this point, it's, you know, these options, if this is what we have and we have comparable options through the marketplace, I'm just not sure what to do, you know, to get those guys covered.
Wow. Thank you. Thanks for your story.
Yeah, let me appreciate the input. And the only thing I would respond is, and I think I can hear it through the tenor of your voice, that obviously you don't buy the rhetoric that the president presented, that if you like the insurance you have, you keep it because you had a policy you like and you thought covered yourself well. Some of the problem in the debate we're having here is that our friends on the other side are saying, well, that wasn't good coverage. I think I'm hearing from your, in essence, testimony to us is that that was good coverage and it was coverage that you liked.
Yeah, it was excellent coverage. I mean, we couldn't ask for anything better. Especially, you know, $250 deductible, you meet that the first time you have a cold and go to the doctor. And with two little boys, you know, I've, my oldest plays sports. I always worry about a broken arm or something. And, you know, anyway, it's just nice to have that peace of mind that we have that. And it's not what it was supposed to be. And for us to keep that would be great, except for, you know, that's not available in our area. We don't qualify for a platinum policy or wherever the $250 deductible would be. $1,000 wouldn't be so bad if it was comparable in price. It's more than, it's 90% of an increase, and that's just, like I said, more than we can handle.
Very good, and you know what? You're a very good English teacher. You're very well-spoken. You don't have to be a math major to figure out that you're getting stuck with a bad plan. Yeah, thank you. So who's next?
I'll go next.
Good.
All right. My name is Mary Swanson. I'm a realtor in southwestern Michigan. My husband owns his own construction company. We are both over 55 and have been paying for independent coverage since neither of us gets it through our employers. We received our cancellation notice the first week of October, much to our shock after having heard that we were going to be able to keep our plans that we were very happy with. Matter of fact, our current plan, which is going away, which is because it's substandard, covered all but $165 of my husband's emergency surgery this summer, which totaled $32,000.
Wow.
Our coverage was deliberately catastrophic coverage. We knew that if we had a year where we were going to have a lot of colds or whatever, we would pay that out of pocket. We also, every year, have contributed the maximum amount allowed to our health savings accounts. And we use that money to offset our $4,000 deductible. Having gotten the notice, I tried to get on to the government website and, of course, could not. So I started shopping around on the individual companies' websites for coverage beginning January 1st. because we have since received two notices that we have to actually apply for and pay for our insurance by December 15th to avoid a lapse in coverage in January. What we found out is that instead of paying $920 a month for the two of us, with a maximum deductible of combined $4,000, we are now looking at somewhere between $1,300 and $1,500 a month. And our deductible goes up to $6,000 each. So we now need to budget, instead of $15,000 a year for health coverage, we now are looking at budgeting $27,000 or more for our health coverage every single year. And we both work in fields that obviously are very volatile since it's totally related on the housing market.
Well, that is really bad. That is really bad. And again, what our bill did when we began to hear these stories is when we wrote this, what I call a pretty simple and well-understood bill, that policies like yours, having it at the beginning of the year, that ought to count, that you ought to be able to retain that. And I credit our leadership, quite frankly, Speaker Boehner and Eric Cantor, our majority leader. They brought our bill to the floor for immediate consideration, vote, debate, literally within 5 or 6 legislative days, which is almost unheard of, to in essence void the subcommittee and the full committee and get right there and actually get the debate time. And I was, in fact, I was over on the Senate side today. House members can go over to the Senate. I was over there, talked to a few members. They were voting back then, but we need to take action on this. And, you know, it is certainly late. I know that the president came out with a proposal the afternoon before our vote when he saw that we were going to win overwhelmingly, and is urging the insurance commissioners to take a review of this. A number of them have already said no. They're not going to do it, but I'd like to think that maybe with the threat of our legislation, maybe the Senate can take this up, and we can get something done to help people exactly in your same shoes.
But I'd like to jump in. I forget the lady's name. I really appreciate the testimony. But listen to the plan that she had, Marion. She had a health savings account, and she had catastrophic coverage. So when you hear the rhetoric that Republicans have no plan, that's our plan. We want to empower individuals to shop for health insurance plans that they want and be able to manage their costs. What we have now is this this federal government program that says we're going to force you to buy a plan that we want for you from a website that doesn't work. And that's really the difference in between the macro debate between the two parties. But we have real issues and a real timeline, Fred, who's the chairman, this December 15th, and what's going to be highlighted by the next constituent from my district, is a real threat, because if they can't buy by December 15th and they want to purchase coverage and they qualify for a subsidy, they won't get a subsidy. So they're going to go without insurance. So maybe we should move on to the next one. We really appreciate that comment.
Thank you. And so it's not only millions of people like you who are getting their individual policy canceled, we know that we've got a number of small business plans as well that are almost next in the queue with, again, millions of policies that are going to get canceled that people actually like and want to keep.
We have some more.
Hello, Fred. If you can hear me, I'm Tim Brown.
Hey, Tim.
Hi. Just spent some time with my insurance advisors, and it's not a very rosy picture. What we wanted to talk about was Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan and many of these other insurance companies have been spending a good amount of time, 2.5 years, to figure out how to meet the compliance set forth in the law. But has that law now somehow been changed verbally by the president? I called Blue Cross today, and they stated, quote, based on President Obama's remarks, we are reviewing impact to the health reform law before we can implement any changes. Can the president issue remarks that literally change the law? And is this Blue Cross's way of saying don't jump to conclusions about what we're going to do about compliance. I wish I had my old plan back.
Yeah, and, well, that's a very good question, which is why, you know, for a number of us, we've been very frustrated over the years with either executive orders or speeches made by the president, czars, all those different things. And I'm not a lawyer, John's not either, but we ask, how is something like that actually able to change the statute? It's not what Congress passed, it's not what the president signed into law. How can anyone just willy-nilly make some of the changes like that? Which was why we felt it was important to move my legislation forward that actually made the change, allowing the states and the insurance companies to continue to provide those policies that folks like you wanted.
Yeah, we don't want to get too macro, but there, I used to teach government history for 4 years, and in the civics classroom, the chief executive officer, which is the role of the president, is the his job title is to enforce the laws of the land, which is kind of comical since he's not complying with the laws of the land. And so that creates distrust in not only the executive branch of the government, but in these laws and the way not only our constituents have to try to comply with them, but how business operates, and it creates uncertainty. And you want to talk about malaise in the economy, that's a direct result.
Well, our plan was called Flexible Blue 2500. We had two office visits, prescriptions, checkups, catastrophic. Our out-of-pocket was capped at $5,000 per family. So they said that's discontinued. What we recommend for you is Keep Fit. Keep Fit has a deductible of $22,000 per family. And it is not HSA compliant, which means, is it a worse plan or a better plan? Well, it's clearly a worse plan. So whenever we hear, well, these were substandard plans, it's just not true. There's another plan that was recommended by someone from Blue Cross. It's called the Bronze. Now, we've heard those gold, silver, bronze. This one's bronze, so it's not the Cadillac plan. The deductible is $15,000 per family in network. The cost of it goes from our current $350 a month to $906 a month. I think what obviously the insurance companies are in a tough spot because they're trying to cover now people that are already sick and trying to get in, and they're trying to at the same time cover me for maternity or for things that just aren't appropriate and products I wouldn't have purchased anyway. So now the government's saying you have to buy a product, and you have to buy a product that you otherwise would not have purchased.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah. That's done.
Now, you want to know why there's a little bit of outrage? Right. Our voices have been raised many times around here about this. It seems to happen about every day. We find some way to spout off about how tough it's going to be. Here I have a deadline of December 31st, and Blue Cross has just said we cannot comment on any impact the president's comments may have made. Are we all in limbo now?
Yeah, you're with millions of other Americans thinking exactly the same thoughts. You really are. And we don't have the right answer that we'd like to provide for you. Bill that we passed, yes, that'd go a long way to getting this resolved, but Senate not taking any action, and here we are, you know, close to December 1, let alone January. Next month, things really do change.
And we know you took time out of your day to help be in this environment with us, so that when we bring our letters to the floor, it's important for us to read these real stories, which I've done a couple times on the floor based on constituents, but also the real world presence by you speaking out here in this forum. But we know that this is going on all over our districts, in the supermarkets, at the basketball games, people are justifiably outraged, and hopefully their elected representatives will respond in a manner. But we're not there yet, and we need you to continue to express your concerns. And I think I can speak to the chairman here, and we'll do all we can on our side to keep raising this issue and hope to get some change.
Yep. Thank you, Tim. Okay. I think we've got one more.
Hope you all keep the heat up on it.
We will. Burners on high. Oh, is that it? So, well, we want to thank Google for allowing us to do this new forum, at least for me. And I know a lot of my other colleagues are doing the same thing, but this is an opportunity for you all to weigh in directly with us and others to see how we act. And I just, for my constituents back home, I look forward to seeing you this next week when Congress is out, and I'm out and about doing lots of different things, as I know John will be doing back in Southern Illinois as well. So we wish you the very best Thanksgiving this next week and family times that we hope will be good for everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.